When you come into Elm, you'll start to see types like string, integer, float, Boolean, so on. And you start to use them, they're really great. And they'll save you all sorts of problems, but they can't save you from everything. So take this code here. It's a type, info, presumably exists in the user module. So user.info, it takes two strings, one is a name, one is an email, and one is and then a Boolean, and returns that. So presumably you would instantiate it with code like this, user.info, name, email, Boolean, and then you get a user info record back. Well, great. But there's a problem here. What if you get the two strings in the wrong order? What if you said, instead of name and then email, email and then name, right? Now, there's literally nothing that the type system can do to check that, because as far as Elm is concerned, a string is a string is a string, right? That this string contains an email address and not a name, it can't determine that. It simply says, oh, it's a string. So we introduce a source of potential errors into our code, i.e. bugs, that we don't want, because what if somebody enters a name into the email field and vice versa? Well, our type checker cannot do anything about that. So let's refactor the code a little, and we get this. Now we've created two new types. We have a type called name and a type called email. And then we create our user info record. And you see we have name is of type name and email is of type email. So we have to do a few extra steps in terms of creating those individual things. But our code becomes much more documented because we know what type name is. And our type checker can do extra duties because where we take a string that is the name and turn it into a name value, you know, can be a well-defined place in our code. We might have a function called toName that takes a string and returns a name, and toEmail that does the same thing. I mean, really, you don't even need that. You just use the type constructor. And then another set of functions that can extract them for displaying to the screen or what have you. But then, in all of the places in our code where we're expecting a name value, we will never get an email and vice versa. So our code becomes much easier to maintain because a class above, where different types of strings can get mixed up, has become impossible because the type checker will find it for us. Now, in this example, I used strings, but this could equally apply to floating point numbers or integers or any number of other types where, you know, you have a generic thing that says, this is a number, you know, the number seven. Well, seven what? $7, seven dogs, seven elephants, seven pixels. Or, you know, something like that. So what we do here is we can say, okay, we can differentiate those and we can make types that say, we can make functions that say, you know, this only works with this kind of data, and not simply say this only works with integers, but this only works with the type that is integers that represent the quantity of inventory, or integers that only represent a number of items in a list or whatever, that allows the type checker to validate more of our results. The more the type checker can do for us, the fewer bugs we have, and the happier we all are. And I'm for fewer bugs.